Hello, traders. Today is Tuesday, March 22nd. Welcome to this live intraday strategy webinar on SB Trade Desk. Great to be with you guys this morning. Tabor, good morning to you. Eileen says, good morning. Hope your Tuesday is unfolding great so far. Can't complain. Although not too happy to wake up to the news that we're hearing with the explosions in Brussels. Our prayers go out to those guys, obviously. Very disconcerting, but nonetheless, back to the markets. There's a lot to talk about. We've been kind of in this wait and see approach. It's been slim pickings with regards to actual scalp positions for me, at least, but we are tracking a couple of different good setups. So we'll go over those today. Obviously, any questions or trade setups you guys have, do feel free to post them on the message board. All right. So before we get started, a quick look at relative U.S. dollar performance as we head into the U.S. session. You're getting some risk off across the board. So real quick, before we get started, if we take a quick look at what the equity board is doing, you know, this was yesterday's performance. You can see that Europe is in the red across the board. Whether this has to do with the terrorist attacks or whether it has to do with broader market sentiment, irrespective, you are seeing that weakness translate. And if we look at U.S. equity futures, those are also trading in the red. So Dow is down about 64 handles, S&P down about 10 handles. Long story short, the relative performance for the U.S. dollar looks like this. You see a mixed performance so far. Worst performer on the session, or strongest performer, I guess, versus the dollar would be the Aussie. Yen up 0.23. Again, that pullback still holding that same range. Dollar yen is coming off big support, so we'll go over that. Loonie with a slight advance of 0.08%. Obviously, dollar CAD is still in focus, still favoring the long side, looking for a pullback to get us back. You had an opportunity actually to take a scalp earlier this morning, but broadly speaking, still looking for that dollar CAD to move higher. Swissy with an insignificant move down up 0.05%. Excuse me. Biggest loser on the session, interestingly enough, is the pound, down 0.79%. And certainly we've been looking at some of the pound crosses. Pound Swiss was something that we talked about yesterday. Pound yen is something that we were tracking last week. All moving lower here so far in the session. A lot of talk again on what these attacks will do to the UK referendum and if it'll have any impact on the vote there. Again, I'm not going to try to extrapolate geopolitical risks here, but long story short, pound is looking like it's going to break support and definitely something we'll want to be paying attention to as well. So looking at the Dow Jones FXCM dollar index real quick. Here's what the chart looked like last night. We were noting that basic 236 right around 11,933. Looks like we made a breakthrough then. As we noted last night, the major level that we're still looking for would probably be somewhere in the range of 11,970 even 11,975. As we noted yesterday, the fact that this 50 line caught the low, which was also the October low, okay, and the rebound taking us through the median line, inherently you're looking for a rally back towards that 50 line for the upper half. And it coincides very nicely with the 50% retracement of the advance off that May low. Also, that longer dated former channel resistance, which I've showed you guys plenty of times in the dollar index, former channel resistance now turned support, or turn support, now resistance, again, all coincide in this region right around that, right around 11,970. So I still think you can get that push higher. Eileen says, when is the UK referendum? Eileen, the UK referendum isn't until June. So that's why all the speculation, all these rumors and the headlines coming out, I don't really want to look too much into it. Again, I mean, that is the biggest risk. If you put a gun to my head right now, I would not think that they would vote to withdraw from the euro area, but we'll have to see. We'll have to cross that bridge when we get there. It's not till June, though, so you do have a couple of months. All right. Good morning, Permendra. Great to see you in the room. So for the dollar index, I do think you can push higher here. If it does push into 11,970, 11,975 region, would definitely be looking for some support triggers, a pullback in price. Now, one thing I also noted last night that I kind of wanted to keep in focus is this trigger and momentum on the daily chart. We'll have to see how this looks as we head into the close today, but certainly on a break, certainly solidifies that push we're looking for back towards 11,970. Long story short, we're still in the descending formation. As long as we stay below the 50 line, I'm still looking for a rally to sell. And near term, again, the immediate risk is for a pop higher here in the dollar. Eileen says, okay. All right. So, thanks for that, Eileen. All right. So, any questions on the dollar index before we move off? All right. So let's jump right into the next radar charts, and we'll jump into yesterday's update, which was obviously on the dollar CAD and the sterling Swiss. Aside from the dollar index, we were looking at Euro Oz, and this is one that basically you held last week's opening range for the entire week. Now we readjusted the slope and we sort of adjusted the levels here. That 618, 4702, still sort of the near-term bullish invalidation level. We've still been sitting in this same range. So for Euro Oz, here's what the daily chart looks like. Oops. Okay. The basic premise here is that major key support that you ran into. This was a nice longer dated 38.2 retracement of the entire advance off the lows. This is a 786, 4754. You can see that median line also been catching some of the lows over the last three sessions. And I'm still not interested in any short exposure unless we break below this region, and specifically that 50 line. If we clear that to the downside, I do think you have a lot to go. But as long as we sit on this support, shorts are at risk. Here's what the intraday chart looks like. And here's what we looked like last night. So again, although we moved that slope, you can see we dropped it to the initial opening range low that we made yesterday. Not really going to stress that slope anymore, but the premise still remains the same. We're looking for a break of last week's opening range. Our favored move is a topside break. At the end of the day, if we do break the lows, you'll be looking for that move sub 147 to open up targets down essentially into the 146.25 handle, that just those swing lows you made last week, but more importantly, 45.60. And 45.60 actually converges on a parallel a little bit later here in the week. There's that convergence right there. So I'm looking for the opening range for last week to give out. And it's certainly if we continue to solidify last week's opening range, which means we come in to that low that we made last week, we've already essentially tested the highs. It certainly adds further conviction on looking for a break of that range. In the meantime, we can scalp the inside of the range. I do favor long scalps. You can see that we've seen some dips here below 40, but you have a trigger that's pending. And certainly on the top side breach, looking for a rally to test the opening range high would certainly be a nice move. Keep in mind, you're working with a larger ATR here. About quarter of daily ATR gives you about 50 pips per scalp. So we'll want to be a little bit more cognizant of that. Is a little bit of a larger ATR. But we'll need to see more so than Euro weakness. I think we'll need, or Euro strength in this pair, I think we'll need to see more so your Aussie weakness. And if we look at Aussie dollar, I still think, or I still have it coming off resistance. So Euro Aussie unchanged. All the levels remain the same. Again, I'm going to keep this slope line in here, guys, just for now. You can see that we've seen some really nice pivots off it on the advance off that low that we made on the 7th. So I'm not going to ditch it just yet. And you can see that we've pivoted and tested it as resistance. If we break back above, it's a different story. We're not really going to stress it so much, but we'll be looking for those rally towards, again, the opening range high. The 618 comes in at 43.40, the 43.39, and the low day close. And this is a very interesting low day close because the low was way down here at 44.65. The close was way up here at 49.90. Okay, so on a topside move, it's really a break above the low day close that would validate sort of a breakout here for Euro Oz. Any questions on this pair? I know, like I said in the report yesterday, guys, it's hard to get excited with it, especially when it continues to hold this range, but there is opportunity. All right, and a quick zoom out photo here just to give you a little bit more of a reference on where we are in trend. And the premise of this trade, again, based on the reaction that we saw on that deep, deep cut back on the 10th, that kind of reaction really keeps the focus higher while above this key support region. All right, so that is Euro Oz. Looking for a break of last week's OR. Last thing I also want to check is just the Euro CAD, which is something that we presented again on Sunday. Very interesting setup. You saw that trigger break in momentum and this break in basic trendline support give us a little bit of a drop here. Here's what Euro CAD looks like right now, first on a daily chart. Not much here to get excited about. I just wanted to highlight that trendline resistance, which continues to be in focus both on the daily chart for Euro CAD and Euro Oz. And we'll be looking to see if that break gives us any play to the upside. Intraday chart looks like this. Oops. Okay. And you could see that break that we saw last night. Didn't get it right there and then, but later in the session you did. So if you had a short on that break against the opening range high, it played out perfectly. Okay? And the drop came right into this level right here, which is the simple weekly open. That's at 46.50. And you're seeing a nice little rebound here. Again, a very tidy weekly opening range. Sometimes these will take a couple of days to get through, guys, but once we clear it, I think we'll get a little bit more of a definitive directional bias. Again, here, that major spike that we saw on the 10th, has us looking higher against that key support that we saw on the daily chart. It's within the confines of a larger descending ML formation. Okay. And the basic premise here is if we break above that 50 line, you look for a rally back towards the upper median line parallel, where again, we would start to look for reassertion of the short side. Till then, we'll have to be sitting on our hands here looking for a break of this weekly opening range, favoring that topside move. On the non-dollar crosses, Eileen asks, how much weight do you give to the respective dollar pair if those non-dollar, for those non-dollar pairs, like Euro Oz and Euro CAD? How do you decide if the Euro is winning for the trend or the other side? I'm not sure I understand the question, Eileen. I think you're saying if I'm looking at Euro CAD, am I looking to see the performance of dollar CAD and Euro dollar? Is that what you're asking? Right. She says yes. Yeah, I do. Now, I always, let me take a step back here one second. I always give you guys a caveat by saying don't necessarily live and die by that sword. Okay. I want to take every trade on its own merits. The dynamics that are pushing euro dollar could be largely dollar driven. They could be largely euro driven. And it's important to recognize when you're looking at that chart what's really driving price action. Because if you take that and you just try to extrapolate it to all the other pairs carrying that base currency, you can really find yourself in a little bit of a mess here. So Eileen, I say this with a very strong caveat, right? We want to always be mindful and take every trades on its own merits. That being said, let me take a segue here. We're talking about Euro Oz a minute ago, right? At support, looking for a topside favorable break of that opening range. If we look at the Aussie dollar, right? That's coming off a big, big resistance, okay? Big resistance confluence. You have the 1618 extension off the low, the key 618 retracement off of that May high. Sliding parallel for the current operative slope off of last year and this year's low, and they all coincide right there. And while we're seeing a little blip in the radar here, I do expect that we'll see another drawback before we start to mount a higher assault. Also, keep in mind on those last two highs that we made into the monthly high so far, you've seen some divergence in momentum, right? Momentum signature not confirming an extreme in price. So even if price pushes into a higher high and the oscillator holds that high, in my mind, that is still divergence. Okay. How do you decide if the dollar is driving or the other? Because of timing, like the Fed meeting, etc., or ECB, that has something to do with it, Eileen. It depends on if the move was prompted by one of the major releases. So, for example, last week, these are good questions. Last week, we saw the Fed right here on the 16th, right, come out and basically say, we're on pause, much more dovish than expected. And you saw that break move to the downside. So obviously the rally that you're seeing in the euro, the rally that you're seeing, or the drawback rather, that you saw in dollar CAD, the rally that you saw in Aussie dollar, this is all based on what's going on in the dollar, right? Well, the dollar's rebounding off support and it's got a little bit more upside to go. So for me, when I'm looking at the euro, well, that means probably a little bit more downside to go, right? But the euro is on a little different bit of a course, because if we look at the near-term chart, the daily, I don't really have too much here, but if you look at the near-term chart, we're still within the confines of this formation, A, and B, we're looking for entries. If you guys remember the update from Sunday, we were looking for entries either at 122, or excuse me, 112.18, that high that we made a few weeks back, or this confluence support right around 111.30. Excuse me, 111.80, 111.83. So you got that drawdown in overnight trade. The low is actually 111.87, and here's a nice little hold and rebound in price. Still don't have a position on. I wish I had taken that long. Obviously, the low happened in early European trade, but I am broadly looking for a turn higher in the euro. So with that premise on the Aussie coming off a little bit more of a sterner resistance, euro. If not the actual median line, before we start to move off again. Okay, so does that answer your question, Eileen? I want to make sure we're on the same page here. Yes, answers the question. Okay, so is a complexity in how to decide that's trading? I don't want to use that word, Eileen. It's I don't want to make it more complicated than it is. And when we're looking at cross analysis like this for different asset classes, you kind of still the main thing I want to stress upon everyone is always taking a trade on its own merits. Just because euro dollar is at support and just because Aussie dollar is at resistance or something of the effect isn't necessarily going to dictate my bias, right? It might affect how hard I want to push the trade, how hard I want to press the trade. But we always want to stress taking every trade on its own merits. All right. So, Euro Aussie, Euro CAD. We went over briefly the Euro dollar. Let's jump into yesterday's update. Okay, thanks for the details. Merits. Cheers, Eileen. Anytime. Here's what the dollar CAD looks like on the daily chart. Here's what dollar CAD looked like last night. Okay, so the premise again, major res support shift right here. You have a key 618 retracement, key 100% extension, my favorite Fibonacci confluences, both of them. Right on the 50 line or right on the ML for this channel formation to the downside. You saw a nice rebound here on that decline, as I noted in yesterday's piece, some really nice divergence in momentum. Price action making a lower low, the oscillator making a higher low. You still have a long dated former resistance trigger again coming into play right along the 40 line. And a breach above the 40 line of momentum and a push through 32.15 specifically, 32.18 here, is needed to really validate a much more substantiated reversal. The key resistance is still going to be up here. The high day close for September and the key 618 retracement, 34.61 to 34.20. This is going to be the reversal play for a full-on reversal in dollar CAD. All that said, we're still in the descending channel. So we're just playing a blip on the radar within the broader confines of the decline. Here's what dollar CAD looks like on the 30-minute chart. So you might have seen this on the swing update from Jamie right before I published this. He got it right on the mark, I think. So a near-term formation just off the low keeps the focus higher in my mind while above. Well, yesterday was above that 30.32 level. I'm going to go ahead and take this and tack it on to the new high that we made in overnight trade. And if we do that, brings up your bullish and validation level near-term somewhere in the range of 130.50. Okay, I would even tag that high from last week, guys. Give yourself a little bit of a range. So near term, here's what I'd be looking for support in dollar CAD. Now, if we break below this, I'd be looking to play into the weekly open again, okay? Maybe key support, but I would not be looking to get anything aggressive until we break 2967, 2980. Again, that major key confluence that we're looking at on the daily chart. Other than that, looking for long buys, long triggers while above this region of momentum. One thing I noted yesterday in the report as well is that objectively speaking, the momentum oscillators continue to hold 60 as resistance, which is not what we want to see if this is going to be a turn in trend. With the same respect, we are getting support ahead of 40. So you're getting some foreshadowing that momentum is turning, that the profile is changing here. But until we get that push through 60 and specific a little bit more of an upward cut through 70, you want to be cautious on the leverage here. But looking for long triggers and looking to stay constructive above 30.44. Any questions on dollar CAD? And interestingly enough, despite the fact that over the last 4 days you've been seeing a lot of real close tight chop action, still giving you about 45 pips per scalp, okay, or about 40 pips per scalp, excuse me. So I do think you get some really nice plays on this once we finally get a more definitive directional break, largely favoring longs above 130.45, bullish invalidation 129.67. Quick reminder, I do see some new names here in the room. You do have the option to take a quick snapshot of any of the charts that you see presented. There's a camera button in the top right-hand corner. Feel free to click on that and take a snapshot of any of the charts you see presented. So if you need to reference them throughout the course of the day, you have those available. What is the level at 131 on dollar CAD? Oh, that was just simply the initial dollar opening range high that we made. We had that highlighted somewhere else, though. Hold on. Yeah, I think, Eileen, it was just a pivot in price at some point. 31 was the high here. This is it, 131. So it was basically the high that we made for July, and a nice pivot in price there. Let me see if that was on the 317 update. Yep, just a soft pivot, Eileen. Just the 31 handle. So when we're looking to set up our scalp targets, especially when you have a 40 pip ATR, the only other target I was looking at was right here at that 3171 level. Okay, so the handle, you can see that the 131 handle gave us a nice little straddle here for a couple of hours before we finally broke. So inherently, I'll tend to leave those right on there. Yeah, that's what I mean. Eileen, plus it's a round number, not so much a round number, just a big figure. So whenever you're talking about euro, 145, 111 in dollar yen, these whole numbers, yeah, will sometimes be a near-term play in price. Any questions on dollar CAD before we move off? More than welcome. Cheers. Okay, and I am still focused on this one. The only other thing I want to say, guys, is that we're really light on data for the week, and it's not like we need data to trade, but the volatility that we're seeing being so tight is kind of it's exacerbated by the fact that we don't have any fresh data for the markets to digest. So the data, the economic docket does start to pick up again next week. In the meantime, we really just got to be watching broader market sentiment. Moving right along, yesterday's Sterling Swiss update. I kind of just wanted to give you an update on this as well. Again, the daily chart here, we were looking to maintain a constructive bias above the March open. And of course, you can see that the March open came exactly at 138.85. Last week, we bottomed out almost to the pip right at that level. So I was looking for a little bit more of a rebound. Now, last night, we noted a couple of things. We had broken, okay, the lower median line parallel. And, the momentum signature was pretty bearish. Okay, you held 40 into the open of the 60 into the open of the week, and then you broke 40 last night. So the propensity for this thing to give us a little bit more of a move lower was there. Bottom line, here's what the scalp chart looked like. Okay, and there was that break. Check as resistance. We actually did make a rallying overnight again to check it as resistance, and then it crashed right through. So the invalidation level broke. Here's what sterling Swiss looks like on the daily chart. There's the March open. There's the median line, lower median line parallel for that operative formation off the highs from last year. A sliding parallel here coincides almost on the 618 retracement, which caught the lows back last month. And that's basically in the range of 3740 into like 3720, 3710. Let me highlight that for you right here. Here's what sterling Swiss looks like on the 30-minute chart. Okay, and you can see again, came back, checked that median line, went into the lower median line, former support, now resistance, a perfect hold, turn ahead of momentum in 60, ahead of 60 in momentum rather, and then there's the break. Once we got through that key support target, your first move is down here into 38.45, and now you're checking the lower median line parallel. At this point, you kind of still want to maintain the favoring of selling rallies while below this region. And again, the major level of support from this point is still going to be that confluence later in the day, right into 37.88, which completes an 88.6 retracement off the low. But more importantly, it's that operative structure which has been defining price so well. All right, so not the necessarily the direction we wanted this to break. As a disclaimer, again, I haven't taken any positions yet this whole week, to be honest with you. Been kind of busy here on the daily FX side of stuff as well. But near term, I've kind of been waiting for these price action or some of this price action to clear out, and specifically the opening ranges to give us a little bit more of a definitive break with where we are in some of these plays. So look for support 37.88 near term. Lower median line parallel. If we rebound into this region in overnight trade or into the US trade session, might be actually a decent move for a near-term rally back to check resistance, former key support, the monthly open, all at 38.45, where again, might be an opportunity to once again try to push the short side on this pair. But the other tell, and this is something you'll hear Jamie talk about every now and then, the other tell that we should have picked up on is the fact that price turned ahead of the upper median line parallel. And a lot of times when these rallies, when these correctionary bounces are failing, a lot of times you'll see them turn ahead of the upper median line parallel if they're bearish, or ahead of the lower median line parallel if it's bullish. And again, suggests that momentum is waning. Interestingly enough, on the rally we made last week, before we added this formation, you can see that price action was giving you some divergence, right? Higher high in price, equal highs in momentum. Turn ahead of the upper median line parallel. All of this should have given us an indication that momentum was waning. The break here solidifies it. Okay, so the immediate risk is for a rebound off the lower median line parallel. I'll acknowledge that much. But you want to stay bearish below that monthly open. Or, like I said, if we get that drop into this region, I would be looking for a possible long scalp back towards resistance. Any questions on Sterling Swiss? Give me a 35 pip quarterly ATR here. Okay, dollar CAD went through Sterling Swiss, Euro AUD, Euro CAD. Okay, I want to touch on sterling dollar and sterling yen, and then I want to jump into your questions, guys. If you have any pairs or specifics that you want to cover, do feel free to throw them on the message board. First up on tap, let's just take a look at the pound in and of itself. Biggest loser so far in the session here in the United States heading into the open. Here's what the pound dollar looks like. Look, we failed at the median line off the lows. Near-term support I was looking for is right here at 4250, 4254. We're probing below it right now. The broader support that we really need to be focused on is still along the median line, right around that 50% retracement, 141.74. Like I noted, that's still going to be our near-term bullish invalidation level. So for the pound, here's what it looks like on the 30-minute chart. Okay, there's that 41.74 level, the 50% retracement we just talked about. Okay, and if we take a parallel, rather, excuse me, of this basic channel, take a parallel and extend it off last week's low, coincides just above that. So a region here of support, of which if we get the drop, I'd be looking for some possible support in the pound. Let me just give you a zoom out here. Okay. Hey, Patrick, great to see you in the room here. It says, new here, how much time do you need to determine week's opening range? Great question. Patrick, we don't want to necessarily stress time as much as price. So, Pat, the opening range for the week can take place on a Sunday, Monday stretch. It can take place on a Sunday into Tuesday stretch. And basically, what you're looking for, Pat, is for the market to set a concerted high and low. Test one of those highs and lows and then break. If you're interested in learning a lot about the opening range strategy, Pat, I would recommend The Logical Trader by Mark Fisher. A great book, really details how he used it specifically in the commodity pits, which is a little bit different of an animal because there is a hard concrete open. But that being said, the idea is sound and certainly has been a part of my strategy for years now. So another thing you want to keep in mind, Pat, is that it's not a strategy in and of itself. Just like RSI is not a strategy in and of itself, just like Elliott is not a strategy in and of itself, these are all tools that we use to help us determine when we should be looking to actually pull the trigger and determine bias. So, Pound is a notorious player that does not abide well with the opening range strategy. If we just look over the last couple of weeks, it's not really been a decent play. Here's been the last opening range that was clear, at least in my mind, for a dollar. Excuse me, for the sterling. You can see on all my charts here, Pat, I know you're new, all the vertical lines designate the weekly open. Okay, so here's your weekly open a couple of weeks ago. I'm just going to walk you through a basic opening range. The market sets a low and then sets a high. This is on a Monday, Tuesday stretch. Okay, once that high and low is set for the week, we're looking for either a break of the low to validate a short bias against the high, or a break of the high to validate a long bias against the low. Now, once that break happens, typically, you look for a late week high. Doesn't necessarily need to be on Friday, could be on Thursday, but you're looking for the price to extend into that extreme towards the latter part of the session. And this is not something that, I'm pulling out of the air, guys. This is studies that we've done that shows that market prices tend to put in their extremes on the opens and close, meaning if the market is in a bullish formation, typically your low will be early in the session, and typically your high will be late in the session. Vice versa for a bearish trade, right? So, I would be inclined to say this is an opening range break if we had gone and tested the opening range high at some point, right? But all this did was move into support, sit there, and break lower. Take it for what it's worth. Pat, does that help? Quick breakdown. I'm going to get to your next question in just a moment. He says yes. Okay, cool. And there is some educational material, guys, on opening ranges. If you check the resource section on SB Trade Desk, we do have some information here on the opening ranges that a lot of people have found helpful. So I encourage you to look through that as well. As far as your next question, he says, what is your determination of bullish or bearish invalidation zones? So, Pat, again, the bullish or bearish invalidation zone is purely based on a level of which, if the market breaks or pushes through, changes my outlook. And what is that based on? Very, very simple. Either it clears a formation that I'm looking at, it clears a key support barrier that I'm looking at, or it clears a major high and low for a monthly open or close type trade. So if we break through, for example, the monthly low from last month, for me, that would be a bullish invalidation level, right? If you're clearing the previous month's lows, you're probably going to see that continue to move off. It's important to note, Pat, that the bullish and bearish invalidation levels that we note on the intraday charts are for just that, intraday. Okay? Doesn't mean that the broader trade, you'll hear me say the broader bearish invalidation, and that's when a break of a zone will change my opinion completely on the medium term. But when we're talking about near term, it just means if this level breaks, we're likely to see a push, much more substantiated push, right? And an example, Pat, is this right here. You get the 50% retracement of the advance. If I zoom out even further, you got the median line for a multi-year formation, right? That we've seen nice pivots on. And you have that sliding parallel for the same operative slope off the lows. So if all three of these factors give out, we're probably going to see this thing go to the lower median line parallel. And that's, my friend, another, 180 pips. So I don't want to be looking for long triggers if this breaks. If this breaks, I want to be looking for long triggers down here. right? And so near term, that's going to be our bullish invalidation level. Whereas it stands right now, Pat, if it comes in here and I get a decent long trigger in momentum, something like this gives out, well, in that kind of scenario, I'd be much more inclined to take a long off this level. Key support and bullish invalidation. Patrick, are we on the same page? And we'll go through more setups, Pat, and it'll come to you for sure. He says, catching up to speed. Thanks. Okay, didn't realize there were more than one way to determine the zone. Great to know. Catching up on speed. Yeah, you're in the right place, Pat, and keep the questions coming, my friend. I hope that helps. I'm sure there's tons of other people with the same question, guys, so feel free to throw out anything that you have. So that's the pound. Look lower first before we even start to think about support, since we broke that major key level that we were looking at early in the week. And like I said, 41.74 is what I'll be reserving as our near-term bullish invalidation level. All right. I also wanted to touch on pound yen. That was a report from a few days ago. I think it was last week. Aha. Okay, here's what pound yen looked like last week. And I just want to highlight this because we're coming into that same exact level, that 49.50, 49.40 level. Still, we're sitting there right now. This is the piece that we put out last week. Initially, we worked with an upside bias as we came into the support. I actually got a couple of decent scalps on this, but they were pretty short-lived. The market was moving rather quick on sterling yen last week. Look, a nice confluence support, 50%, 236 retracement. You had building divergence even into that final low, okay? Ahead of the BOE, and certainly that popped to the top side, coming into the upper median line parallel, and that's been holding his resistance, and it held his resistance into the close of the week. Here's what it looks like right now. First on the daily chart. Okay. Here's the formations we've been working with, or here are the trend lines of the slope that we've been working with. All of these slope lines, guys, are derived from this basic pitch using just the November low high or high low high. So this same slope that was derived from these three points has continued to define so many turns in price. Okay? It's continued to catch some really nice pivots, and it's continued to catch some really nice lows. So, looking at pound yen, our focus was, hey, look, while we're above that stretch low we made back in February, while above the 50% basic retracement, momentum has made its first nice break above 50 after some really radical divergence into the lows. I was looking higher and long scalps while above 59.40. Well, that's out the window now, okay? Here's what it looks like on the intraday chart. So, that same pitch from last week. We tried to make a topside break yesterday. This is an example. Pat, this was for you. Sorry, I was looking through the comments. This is an example, Pat, of an opening range strategy, my man. Here's your Sunday open. Okay. We make a high somewhere in the range of 161.35. You pull back into near-term support pivot, 60, 160, 160.12. We went back to check the opening range high and failed. Okay? So inherently, you're looking for a break of the opening range low. Once that happened, it confirms a bias against this high. And here we are moving into that major key support barrier. Again, we've adjusted some of the levels. So the 236 is not there anymore. We're just working with the 50. But more importantly, that 50 line, that median line off the highs, we're straddling it right now. The risk is for a move lower. One other tell on the directional bias, okay, is the fact that momentum. Yeah, we got some crazy divergence building all last week, but guess what? Couldn't clear 60. Couldn't clear 60. Couldn't clear 60. 40 break, and yet another 40, and even 30 break. So again, Pat, you're new to the room. Some of the other guys here that are new to the room, keep in mind when we're looking at momentum, some nuances you don't hear about too often. And something that's very important is that you can find so much more information in these oscillators than just overbought and oversold. Okay? When we're in strong downtrends, we want to see momentum hold sub 60, not 70, it's 60. Okay, when you see these failures at 60, a break below 40, failure at 60, a break below 40, these are all healthy for a broader downtrend. On the flip side of that, Pat, when we're working with a constructive bias or a bullish bias, we want to find support at 40 and multiple breaks above 60. On the pullback, support at 40, on the rally, breakthrough 60. So here is a perfect example of momentum profile that still hasn't turned. Okay, now the next key support target to the downside isn't too far away. It's 158.30 into 158.48. You're looking at a 618 extension and a 618 retracement. So a nice confluence region there of support. And beyond that, you'd be looking for a continuation just into the lower median line parallel or basic trend line support. Okay, wider range ATR here as well, working about 53 pips per scalp. Is a quarter of the daily ATR, which is what we like to use as our profit targets. Likewise, obviously, we can't risk more than that on our stops. Pat says the failed retest makes sense. Yeah, and typically those are the best plays, right? And Pat, you're not always going to get an opening range, right? So if the market opens and it's just a slow dribble like it was last week, there's nothing to do with it. The opening range is not going to offer any help on that scenario. So know the strengths of the tool that we're using, and also know when it's not going to be beneficial for us to stress that. Questions on pound yen. I guess since we talked about the abomination, we should look at the abomination. And here's what dollar yen looks like so far on the daily charts. I know that Jamie also highlighted this in his swing update last night. Okay, so I think me and Jamie are in the same sort of boat here near term, and we're looking for, in my mind, I'm looking for a little bit more of a concrete bounce to the upside. Momentum has not been very encouraging, but price action is still largely holding a big region. And for those of you who have been in the room, you've seen this before, but just in case, for anyone who's new, basic trend line support extending off the low from, what is that, April of 2013, tagged again in June. Almost came into it back here in 2014. Look where it coincides today or this week, right? That same trend line comes in exactly with a 2618 extension off the high, exactly at the monthly low we made for February. And again, the lower median line parallel for the current operative slope. So on this low, what else is happening? Remember, when we're talking about divergence, it's all about the close, right? Lower low, lower low. Well, oscillator's doing higher lows, higher lows. So I'm very, what's the word? Cautiously constructive here on dollar yen. You guys know I'm not a real big fan of dollar yen in general. But off of this region, I do think you look higher while above that 111 handle. Now, for me, even if you break 111, one thing I want to note is that lower or the broader median line that you're looking at right here. Look at this. So this is a formation extending off the high low for December of 2014 and last year's high. You can see the slope comes in right there at that high from October of 2014. So the 2014 October high coincides dead on with the lower median line parallel for that multi-year operative slope, which again, you can see the slope has caught some very nice turns in price. A break of the median line charged a more concrete drop. And if we break here, I still don't want to get too excited. You might get some decent short scalps into 110, but this is the drawdown zone. A break below that 110 area, I think, would be sort of it'd open the spigot. This thing would just start to really tumble lower. So that's the major key support still, even if we do peak below this region. Okay. That being said, I'm looking for a little bit more of a basing here in dollar yen. Here's what it looks like on the 30 minute. And dollar yen sometimes plays really well with the opening range strategy. And then one example of that is what we saw last week. Okay. Now there's different ways you can interpret this break. For some guys who are much more play it much more closer, this is the initial opening range. This is the initial opening range break. Even those probed back into the opening range strategy dictates a short bias against the opening range high. I would be more comfortable calling this Monday, Tuesday stretch the opening range. You tested the opening range high, failed at the weekly open. You broke through. Look for that late week low. You got it on Thursday. So we're setting up an opening range here for the week, just above that major key support confluence. There's a lot down there. You made a high, you ran right into 112.15, 112.16, and overnight, you pulled back. Again, if we get a move back into this region, some nice long triggers, I'm still favoring the long side. One other thing I'd note is the momentum signature is starting to turn a little bit more constructive. Okay? This is the highest read that we've seen in momentum, and certainly the highest read into overbought that we've seen since back in early March. And on the pullbacks, we'll look to see if this oscillator gives us a little bit more support at that 40 region. We probed through it earlier today, but we'll want to see if that gives us some support. I just want to check this out real quick. Just bear with me. Okay, let's smooth it out a little bit. Hey David, says Fernando. Sorry I logged in really late, but what time ballpark will the recording be available on the website? We end at 9:30, David. I usually have it up by 10. Takes me a minute. It just has to render the whole video, but I should have that up by 10. Yeah, you're more than welcome. Any questions on this dollar yen? I really, again, my distaste and hatred for the dollar yen is still put aside here because I do think we pan out. Look, if it breaks the downside, like I said, 110 and beyond 110, it's going to be a massive drop if we break that. All things held constant, still looking for some support and still looking to maintain a constructive bias while above 111. All right. A quick run through some of the commodity trades that we've been following as well. I don't really have much to say on gold. It's been a real lackluster trade. The only thing I'm really looking at is that basic trend line support, which still seems to be in play. And I guess for gold, the weekly chart and the 30-minute or the 2-hour chart are actually more telling than that daily chart. So here's what the weekly chart looks like for dollar for gold, just to give you a reference on where we are. Basic trendline resistance off of that late 2013 high is what I've been focused on. We've been straddling it for the last 4 weeks. As momentum continues to hold 70 resistance and price action pushes higher. So the risk for a pullback is there. The trade remains constructive above 112, essentially. It's 1193. So as long as we stay above 1200, I don't really want to stress too much a bearish bias here on gold. I am expecting a near-term pullback. Largely speaking, we'd be using that pullback to maintain a constructive approach. Here's what the 4 hour looks like, or the 2 hour rather, for gold. If you guys remember, this formation is what we were looking at a few weeks ago. It's consolidation formation. You saw a topside breach. The 100% extension held resistance. We came back. You can see that that same trend line support has been a decent pivot in price, support, resistance. Now I'm more inclined to use this sort of basic slope off the lows, and we'll look to see what the opening range does here for gold. Broader focus still remains weighted to the upside, well above that 1194 region. Any questions on gold? Last but not least, crude. Shouldn't be surprised to anyone. We covered this yesterday in the webinar as well. The break above 39.97, essentially the 40 handle, still keeps us looking higher. Initial resistance, we turned right ahead of it. So I'm not sure if you're going to get that spike into it. But the initial resistance target we noted last week was this 200-day moving average, which is now at 41.86. Key resistance, still 42.80 or 42.76 into the 43 handle. Big, big region. Okay, you have the median line for the current operative slope. 1618 extension off the low, 618 extension off the high. And while this is a retracement that is long dated already, we've cleared the high and low. You've seen some really nice pivots here, right? Caught that low to the pip, caught that high to the pip. And again, all of those converge on the median line. Also, note the change in behavior that we've seen in crude. You know, these guys who are still looking for crude at 25 bucks, I just don't get it. I just don't get what they're looking at or if they're even looking at technicals. But this is a market change in behavior. Okay, this is the highest reading we've seen in momentum, the first break above 60 since back here. And you can see that that still had a long ways to go to the rally before it turned over. More so than that, on the daily basis, is the divergence we made into these lows, right? So could get a pullback from here, look for support at former resistance. Again, you also have a basic trend line, which is coming into that region as well, and the median line for the current operative slope. Look for support near this region. Again, looking for that final stretch near 43. When price hits a, this is from Pat saying, when price hits a support or resistance that we predetermine, what trigger are we looking for to enter a bullish candle, engulfing hangman, or a break above or below a small moving average? Just enter as close to that level with limit orders. So Pat, in our personal, in my personal strategy, let me tell you that for scalping on a near-term basis, we're usually looking at this. So I have my levels. Let me bring up that dollar cat. See if we have anything juicy here. Oh, we just missed it. Here's dollar cat. Actually, you could have asked that question a little bit quicker, we would have gotten it. Here's dollar cat, right? And I usually have my levels, my scalp levels mapped out in the 30 minute, so I know what I'm looking to play. Obviously, the daily chart is non-negotiable, right? The daily chart has to be a paramount in our analysis because it highlights major, larger key levels, and it helps us dictate broader trend. Once we have that picture in our head, we have our levels mapped out. I'm looking for triggers and momentum. So Pat, as price comes into support, you're looking for long triggers and momentum. As price is coming into resistance, you're looking for short triggers in momentum. And basically, we use these triggers as basic trend line support and resistance. And you could do them in the oscillator just as you do them in basic price. So here was a trigger for the short side yesterday in dollar CAD on the rally. Okay, price action making higher high, higher high, higher high, a series of equal or lower highs in the oscillator. Once we break this, you have a downside move. Can you fit a stop that is within 40 pips away, which is a quarter of the daily ATR? Yes, you can. That's a trade you look to take, looking for that downside move. Okay. Same thing on the ascent here. Price action coming into support. Obviously, I would have liked, like I told you guys earlier in the session, a move back into this region as price comes into support. Strap on a quick retracement, excuse me, a quick resistance trigger. Or actually, on a move like this, the resistance trigger would have been better off. Remember, the more points of contact you have, the better. So just like a basic trend line, 2 points is speculative, 3 points is confirmed. Here's a trigger right there. As price is holding above 40 in momentum, that's constructive. We would have liked to use that as a trigger to, again, to get back on the long side. So this is one way you can use to help you ascertain when you should be actually pulling that trigger. And remember, the most important thing, Pat, is your risk to reward. So unless you can put a 40 pip stop against a major high, a major low, a session high or a session low, or even a major support level, we can't take the trade. And that's what we base the merits of the trade on. Can I get inside a 40 pip stop? Great, jump in. So, Pat, quick walkthrough. I hope that offers some help on that end. And welcome aboard, my friend. He says, that's great. Exactly what I was looking for in the answer. Cheers, Pat. We're not too big on moving averages here. One thing we just want to note, you know, the moving averages are typically in well-known. Well, let me just say this. All oscillators are well-known to be lagging indicators, right? They tell you what has happened, not what's going to happen. So Pat, the only thing that I really stress on moving averages is on the daily chart, okay? Your 100-day, your 200-day moving averages, on your weekly chart, your 52-week moving averages, you know, these sorts of longer-term moving averages that all market technicians will tend to look at is something we need to be mindful of. But actually using moving averages on a short-term strategy, unless we're using like a five, or if you know James Stanley from Daily FX, he likes to use a finger trap, which is a moving average type of momentum strategy on a really near-term basis. That's different. But for our purposes, we're basically looking to use those oscillators as triggers, right? So I hope that helps. Eileen saying, so maybe dollar cash short now, stop would have been above that 31 handle. So yeah, the stop would need to be any short exposure here, the stop would need to be against the session, the opening range high. Also, Pat, by the way, you can get an indicator called trading sessions or trade sessions, excuse me. You can find this on fxcodebase.com or fxcmapps.com. And what it does is it simply highlights the high and low for every trading session around the globe. Not the opening range, but this is the highs and lows. And again, can help you ascertain really quick, get a gauge on where the market has been in US trade, in London trade, in Tokyo trade, etc. So, Eileen, to answer your question, would that be a good short for dollar CAD? Again, personally, not interested in shorts on dollar CAD right now. I'd be interested in shorts post a break sub 30.45, but I'm not really interested in taking a short right now. Yes, I see what you're looking at. And in fact, we can look at a couple of different things. This is some pretty nice divergence. Price action higher high on a close basis, the oscillator lower high, and there's even a decent momentum trigger here. Right? But support's not too far off. Still at 30.50. Right? It gives you basically a 30 pip range here. We're looking for about 39 pips. So it's tight. And broadly speaking, we've been talking about this, looking for a pullback to get long. So knowing where we want to pick and choose our battle. Even with oil up, says Eileen. Yeah, even with oil up. Remember, every trade on its own merits. And as we said in oil just a couple of minutes ago, you could see oil come all the way back here into 39, 39.80. Right? That's oil price weakness. If you look at the correlation, it's not that strong. But that being said, yeah, dollar CAD could see a little bit more strength pushing towards that 30.45 level. But either way, I'd be looking to get a long position if I can against that level. Are we cool? Make sense? Merits, 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 right. Thanks, says Eileen. Cheers. Love the enthusiasm as always. Pat says, copy, have it, but didn't know how to use it. There you go, Pat. Yeah, it can be. Are you talking about the trade session indicator? It's been a real cool help for me because when I'm scalping on the intraday basis, I can easily find where the session high is, and that's what I want to know. So Pat, just to, again, I don't want to segue too far off topic here, we're running out of time, but Pat, just to, one other caveat is we talked about weekly opening ranges, right? These also happen on a monthly basis. These also happen on a session basis, which is what I like to use, this for. So far, for example, the opening range for US is set, right? You made that high, you tested that high, you probed through it. Here's the low. Really easy to identify. Again, if we come near the low, really nice stop against the London opening range low. Looks good to me, right? And we'll see if we can get that long trigger available off that region. If we crash through the London opening range low, well, look out below, okay? Could see that breaks up 30.45, which would shift our bias to selling rallies back towards key support. So we can use the opening ranges also on a session basis. Typically, the first hour, hour and a half of trade, we'll see the same thing, a high-low high set, and then we'll look to see the break of that. On a monthly basis, and this is something right now that's apparent in dollar yen, which is sort of throwing things off gauge, dollar yen set up a beautiful monthly opening range. Here's the monthly open. Monthly opening range high was at the median line. We tested the lows, we tested the highs, and here's the break of the low. So this is a perfect example of an opening range, but the break took us into a key support structure. And nothing with a capital N and a capital thing supersedes basic support and resistance, right? So although the opening range strategy here for the month would suggest that we have a downside bias for dollar yen, we're at key support, and I'm not going to stress it unless we break below that region. Okay, so again, every trade on its own merits. So dollar CAD too close to support, but close to resistance too, sticking between 40 and 60 on the RSI range play. Yeah, I mean, if anything, the RSI signature looks a little bit more constructive, Eileen, because we're seeing support in turns ahead of 50, and even the break sub 50 are not really reaching into the 40 territory. So it still stayed. This looks a little bit constructive, but it's not bullish, right? We haven't seen that 60 break in momentum and that 70 break in momentum. These things are healthy, for uptrends. A lot of people see this and say it's time to sell. Yeah, but that's just near term. Broadly speaking, multiple breaks into overbought is something that's very healthy for a broader uptrend. So, yes, I would be looking for a pullback here to possibly get support. I'm not sure if it's too close to resistance necessarily, Eileen, but there's no long triggers on tap yet. I've been out of dollar CAD, doesn't seem so clear to me. Give it time. Give it time. Okay? We're not in the cleanest formation, but I think the levels are pretty clear, Eileen. So we just need to wait till price gets to an extreme. I mean, needs to get through this level here, and a break below, and we'll look to sell rallies more favorably in my book. Look for that pullback and look for possible support here for some possible long triggers off that 34, 30-45 level. All right. Guys, we'll wrap it up there. US markets are 2 minutes into the open already. So we'll pick things up tomorrow morning at 8:30 Eastern for another intraday strategy webinar. We'll have an update later for you later tonight as well. Again, the economic docket is pretty spent. There's not much on tap. I do just want to highlight a couple of different things. We do have the market manufacturing PMI on tap. That's in about 10 minutes. You're looking for a slight uptick. This is the preliminary read for March. So we'll get another update to that number, but we are looking for a revision from 51.3 up to 51.9. Richmond Fed Manufacturing Index comes in later in the session at 10 o'clock a.m. Eastern. More importantly, look at those comments you're going to get from Fed President Charles Evans. You also get some comments from Fed President Patrick Harker. I wouldn't stress them per se, but every commentary that's coming out of these central bankers is getting all the headlines and certainly has the propensity to change expectations. We'll come back and revisit this tomorrow as far as where we stand on the Fed futures funds rate, which is again gauging what we should be expecting from the Fed moving forward. The only thing I wanted to highlight here is you are starting to see a slight build towards that July print, with market participants factoring in a 49% or a probability that we'll see an interest rate hike into the 0.5 to 0.75 range, currently at 25 to 50. And we'll see changes in this, and we'll continue to track changes in this. Outside of major economic developments, you're not going to see this shift too much. And with the economic docket pretty quiet for this week, again, like I said, we'll really have to focus mostly on broader market sentiment. All right. Great answers to my questions, says Patrick. Thanks for your patience. Have a great day. Pat, no need. You're in the right place. Questions are always welcome, my friends. Guys, best of luck trading, and I will see you tomorrow morning. Cheers.